Hi there, I'm Scott Valentine. This video was suggested by Daryl Heath through my Facebook page, and Daryl was wondering how to combine multiple 3D objects within Photoshop CS5 Extended. To demonstrate this, I'm going to show you how to create this book and this ring, and then how to combine them together so that they interact and create the shadow effect. Now, individual 3D layers do not interact in Photoshop. In order to have one object cast a shadow onto another or to show reflections, they have to be in the same 3D object layer. So let's go ahead and get started by turning off my final view here. I'll select a blank layer called Book and choose a path that I previously created. I'll fill the path with black, and then we'll extrude it using the Repoussé tool under the 3D menu and selected path. That's going to create an object into the depth of the page, and you can see that here. Let's increase that extrusion depth to 5.5, and now we need to apply a material to this extrusion, which is the sides in this case, and I just want something that will be a placeholder for the diffuse texture and the bump map, so I'm going to choose this moss material which ships with Photoshop. Click away to close that. Choose better mesh quality to get smoother curves. And then before I close it, I'm going to reset the orientation back to its initial mesh position and select OK. And when it's all done, we go back to our layers panel, and you can see if I move the camera around that we've got this texture applied. I'll get rid of that right now by choosing to turn off those textures since we don't need them for this particular video. And let's see if we can get the orientation of the book back to where we started with using straight on camera from this drop down menu. Next, we need to create our ring. This will be another 3D object on a layer by itself, and this is from a built-in object called ring. You'll see it'll place it right here in the center of our canvas, and there right now is no relationship between the book and the ring, so we'll fix that in just a moment. The first thing to do is to orient the position of the ring, choosing one of the orientation or position tools, and choosing Book from the drop-down menu. Book shows up there because it's one of the other 3D objects within this document, and we want them to coordinate. So in order to coordinate them, we have to choose the same orientation. And you'll see it jumps a little bit. Where it'll position is kind of a mystery sometimes, but don't fret, we'll square everything up. And then we'll choose the same options from the camera. There's also a book orientation or a book setting. And that puts these two in the same spot. Now we don't want to move too many things around here because we might mess up the coordination between the two. So let's go ahead and merge them right away. With the ring layer selected, I'll choose to hold down the Shift key and click on Book. Once again to the 3D menu and merge 3D layers. Now you'll notice the book and the ring are roughly the same size, which of course won't work for our final image. Let's just take a look here, see. We need to shrink the ring down, so we'll have to choose to operate on its mesh independently. And we'll do that with the 3D panel over here. Now a quick note, you'll notice that most of the time when I'm moving the scene around, I try to use just the camera. And even when I'm manipulating individual objects on different layers, I try to just use the camera so I can put everything back in place. It's just a workflow that happens to help me coordinate, because if you start moving around with position and camera both, it's much more difficult to maintain orientation for these things. So choose whatever works for you, but I recommend trying the camera first. Let's take a top view, the camera tool selected. And I just want to point out here that if you use the zoom camera tool that by default for some of these views, orthographic is chosen, which means you don't have any perspective. We're going to leave that on for now, but just for demonstration, if you choose the perspective on this, for some odd reason, your object is very far away. You can see that your standard field of view is 0.1. And so I like to just stick with the orthographic scale. And from this orientation, I can choose filter by meshes, choose my ring, and now I'm going to choose the 3D mesh pan tool. If I click and drag out here, we've got control over just the mesh that's selected in the 3D panel. Let's choose the mesh scale tool, click and drag, and now we'll have to bring the mesh a little bit forward by using the mesh slide tool. Dragging down will bring it closer to the camera. That's it. And a lot of this operation is just going to be iterative. You're going to have to tweak it once in a while, go back, tweak the other parameters that you've already set, and kind of go back and forth. So that looks like a good size for our ring. Now let's change its orientation. I'll use that with the 3D axis tool here. And the axis that's pointing at us is the one that we want to rotate around. There's a set of tools here that you can use to rotate. So when you mouse over the blue one right here, we're actually rotating it. So let's get about 90 degrees. That's it. Go back to our camera tool and look at the straight on view again. And we can see our ring is kind of floating up here. Let's zoom in a little bit on that. Go back to our mesh tool, and this time I can just use the axis tool, so it doesn't matter which of these tools I've selected. The axis tool will override that. So let's start positioning our ring closer to the book. And I'm clicking and dragging on these elements, on these pieces of the 3D axis tool. All right, now we can zoom back out to our normal size, grab the camera, and start setting up where our render is going to be, and then we can position the ring and the book a little more closely. To help me, I've got a little cheat. I've created a guide overlay for my previous render so I can get close to what we had before. Now I'm going to do this entirely with the camera tool, so let's rotate things around. We'll scale it up a little bit. There we go. Choose the camera rotate tool. We'll start getting our positions roughed in. Okay. Do some alignment there, and now we'll change the perspective. And in this case, perspective is already selected, so I'm going to increase the field of view here to about 135. That's it. And we'll zoom in a little bit here using the walk tool for the camera. And this crosshair is going to help me define the size of the ring in relation to the size of the book. It doesn't have to be exact, but I wanted to get close to what my previous render looked like. So an awful lot of this, like I said, is going to be going back and forth, changing one detail usually changes the rest. I like that orientation. Let's zoom in a little bit more. Let's try 150. Okay. That looks good. All right. I think we're looking pretty good there. 165 to zoom in a bit more. Okay, so we've got our orientation pretty well. We'll go ahead and select the ring, or select to move the ring again. And you notice that this orientation is already set up in the same plane as the book. So I'm going to use that to slide the ring back into place. And I'm also going to use the fact that these meshes will collide a little bit, and you'll see what that means here in a second. If I drag this ring down into the book, you'll see that the ring sort of collides, right? The meshes interact. I'm going to use that fact to help me position exactly where the ring should be. We want it to collide almost evenly on both sides there, and then back it off just a touch so that the ring is sitting just on the edge of that page there. Let's turn off this guide overlay and check out our lights real quick. I know I only want two of these lights, but before we go into this too much, let's select the scene and see what we've got already. These are the default lights, I haven't changed anything. So let's try Ray Trace Draft and see what we get. There we go. You can see the shadow of the ring falls back here from one light. There's another light that's pointing up this direction, and then we've got a shadow cast on here from another higher light. I only want two, so let's go ahead and get rid of infinite light number 3 by clicking on it and seeing what we've got left. There we go. That looks pretty good. We'll click to interrupt, and now to make things faster, we'll go back to interactive painting. Alright, so I like this render position, and I want to make sure I can come back to it, so I'm going to choose my camera tool again and select this disk icon so that I can save this particular view, which I'll call render. And now I can go back to things like this top view and reposition my lights and select our light rotate tool. And let's see, I'll leave the second light as the infinite light. We'll drag it around so it sits right on top of the page to give some broad, soft illumination. That's it. And then the second light I actually want to turn into a spotlight. I can do that by choosing light type and changing it. And it doesn't change its name automatically, so I'm going to double click on it and rename that spotlight so I can keep track of everything. Let's go ahead and render this real quick just as a draft to see where the shadows are falling. And so we know by looking at this where all of our lights are laying and where our camera is. So our camera is about down here, and let's choose our render view just so that we can convince ourselves. Right, so the camera and that spotlight are roughly the same spot. Let's go back to interactive again and choose our top view and reposition that spotlight so it's on the other side. We'll just grab our light pan tool. I'm going to slide the spotlight up to here. Turn off the infinite light here for a moment. Turn on the spotlight, and I'm going to alt-click on where the ring is so that I can have the spotlight point back towards the ring itself to cast our shadow in the appropriate spot. Let's move it around here. Alt-click again. And that helps target our spotlight. And I think that's probably going to be pretty good for us. Let's just see what the shadow looks like from the top here real quick. There we go. That's not bad. Let's slide that light tool down a little bit so it's closer to the page. By clicking on spot. There we go. We'll make it lower. And that's looking pretty good. Let's alt-click on the object again. There we go. I think that's looking not bad at all. Go back to interactive so we can do some fine-tuning here. Turn on our infinite light. We'll soften its shadows here a little bit and give it just a little bit more warmth. There we go. We'll do the same thing with our spotlight. Bump up its intensity and increase its softness to about 30%. And let's see what we get with that. There we go. It's looking pretty nice. Go back to interactive, choose our camera, and go back to our render setting. And now let's go ahead and take a look at what we've got by letting the render run a little bit longer. That's looking pretty good. I actually like that positioning. We've got a nice shape on the heart, and we've got our 3D objects interacting. You can see the spotlight is creating this soft shadow around here. The overhead light is creating just a slightly harder shadow, and those two shadows are actually interacting themselves. So we could let this run, and you'll notice the noise around these edges and the softness will start to go away. And that will actually be a pretty good foundation. I've only got it on draft, so we didn't let it run to completion. But this is not a bad start. So in the second part of this video, what I'll show you how to do is apply the texture for the written text or the material right on this page. It will adjust the ring's material so it has a nice shiny gold effect, and do some other touch-up work to make it look a little more real. So I hope you've gotten how to combine 3D objects and set up lights out of this video. And I look forward to you joining me next time where we'll add materials and do some final tweaking. Thanks a lot. I'm Scott Valentine.